When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, tumble and fall, or the mountain should crumble to the sea. I won't cry, I won't cry, no, I won't shed a tear, just as long as you stand by me.
Good evening. I invite you to stand as we prepare to worship God. Yes. Jesus said, I'm resurrection and I am life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I'm sure neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. If we live to the Lord, if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. We are gathered here in this place to give thanks to God for the life of Rivon Cleophas Skeete. Let us now receive his body for burial. With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother, Rivon Cleophas, for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother, Rivon Cleophas. We thank you for giving him to us. his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gates of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Kindly be seated. On behalf of the family, we wish to welcome all of you to this service of thanksgiving for the life of our brother, Rivon. We trust that this experience would be, even though a sad one, be one where we continue to give God thanks for having given him to us, and now you have taken him back for yourself. And so with that assurance, we now hear words from the Holy Scripture coming to us from 1 Corinthians 15, beginning at the 51st verse, and we invite Mr. Skeete to come.
All right. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, the trumpet will sound. The dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the word of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Here is the reading.
We will now have a musical dedication, Even the Sky, and after that, it will be followed by tributes by Andre Emmanuel and Anderson Jordan.
Brightly, and the flowers don't wanna bloom. Seems like the sun got lazy. It wakes up in the afternoon. The wind don't wanna bloom. The stars align, but I think the stars are lying. 'Cause without you in my world, even the sky is crying. Even the sky is crying. The sky is crying. Even the sky is crying. Need you to come back. Come back. Come back. I need you. Need you to come back.
Is a vision. But every today well spent makes every yesterday a wonderful memory and every tomorrow a vision of hope. That's my motto, my motto, my motto.
Thank you so much, Daddy, for those words. Thank you for your motto. Thank you, Day, for that beautiful and original song. We appreciate it. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. This is a farewell to a dad who had a life well lived. Today I bring you greetings from Massachusetts on behalf of the Lane family, the Emmanuel family, the Dalmar family, the John family, and even though my husband can't be here with me today, his family from Nigeria sends their greeting, the Amechi family. I must thank everyone that reached out to offer support. I am grateful for my church family at the Attleboro Seventh-day Adventist Church, my work family at the Department of Mental Health, my Taunton Attleboro site office colleagues, the EPIA team, and the staff of clinical and professional services. The love was appreciated and warmly welcomed. It is with great sadness that I say goodbye to my dad, Rivon Cleophas Skeete. As a firstborn and an only child, for the first 4 years of my life, he was only my dad, my dad. He was my first love. He demonstrated his love in many ways. He bought me beautiful dresses when you worked at Covez. I'm sure he did for you too, Laura. He spent time explaining how to maneuver the obstacles that arose in my life, and there were many. Even though I migrated to Massachusetts with my mom and her new family, my dad remained a visible force in my life. He made trips to the U.S. to visit with me when I was a child, as an adult, and as an adolescent.
He ensured that I knew that I was his priority. And distance would not separate us. We chatted quite often on the phone, especially at night. His voice remained spirited and vibrant even during the last week of his life. He was an amazing man. Daddy was an interesting person. He was well-versed on all topics, money management, health, current events, you name it. He loved politics. He had an affinity for U.S. politics and would always stay abreast of the latest news. Conversing with him was a delight. I always knew that I would walk away with a nugget, some little thing I can use in the future, that I could then add to my repertoire of information and later share with friends as needed. In the latter part of his life, he requested and I created a YouTube page for him. He called it Rivon's Facts of Life. And he had a lot of facts. He intended to share the wisdom that he acquired throughout the years. Since life came to an abrupt halt and he was unable to complete the task, please allow me to share a few facts. Fact number one, he was a self-made man, a man with a vision and a plan to attain his goals. Despite humble beginnings, education opened doors for him. You hear that? Education opens doors and elevated his life. I watched him build his primary residence from an idea to a piece of land that he acquired to a physical building that we call home. He named it Audra Lara after his first two daughters, as he wanted us to feel connected to the dream. But Toby, don't feel alone, because you weren't thought of at that point, but you are a part of the dream now. As a child, I walked on the grass and listened to him discuss elaborate plans that came to fruition. He was viewing the architectural plans and told me where my bedroom would be. Ladies and gentlemen, I love that bedroom to this day. Fact number two, don't worry, there are not too many facts. Fact number two, he made all three of his children feel special and demonstrated that he was proud of us. I am the first child, and he would always address me as the firstborn. He would say, "How is my firstborn doing today?" I thought that being the firstborn made me so special. Then he would tell me all these stories about my sister Laura Mae and address her as the exec. Oh, short for executive. He was so impressed with her and her accomplishments and viewed her as a boss. I realized that she too was special. Then he would talk about the third love of his life, his male child, the king, Tovia, the one who is charged with continuing the Skeete's name, the lineage. He was so proud of all of us that he showcased our degrees in his office. And if you've been there, you've seen it. Fact number three, he was a handsome, charismatic man with a sweet smile and a welcoming personality. He dressed sharp, was always neat and clean, and carried himself with style. He specialized in communicating with people in person or over his radios. I hear there were a few different kinds of radios, maybe the ham radio and then another kind of radio, but he did it well. I was always impressed at how comfortable others were when interacting with him. He always gave a compliment and made people feel worthy. It was clear that people gravitated to him for his expertise and his personality. And the final fact, fact number four, of all his great attributes, his spiritual awareness was the most impressive. In his final days, he talked a lot about God. One Sabbath on my way to church, and Daddy would always call me on some Sabbaths, but often call me on some Sabbaths, he said, "Did your mother tell you that I prayed for her?" Not once, but twice. So I usually take my mom to church. So she's in the car. She said, "Oh, yes, he did." So she confirmed it, and he was so proud of himself. He was so proud of himself that he prayed for her. He said to me, "Audra, I know God, and I pray to him." He would recite specific verses in the Bible. He would often call and wish me a happy Sabbath. I was delighted that our dad had become so spiritually inclined in his final days. It reminded me of the thief on the cross who received salvation at the end of his life. It is my prayer for his life that one day when Jesus comes again, he would wake up from that golden container, wake up, and have everlasting life. In hindsight, it appears that he was preparing me to accept his departure and his alignment with God. When all is said and done, I choose to appreciate and celebrate the life that he lived instead of only focusing on his death. My dad was so much more than just death. Even though we might be sad that he is no longer here, he would continue to live within us. A friend of mine gave me a wind chime that read, "Listen to the wind and think of me. In your heart, I'll always be. May we all find peace in his rest."
Good afternoon. Tribute to Rivon, or Rivon, but most of us call him Rivon. I have known Rivon working at COVID's garment factory as a marketing supervisor in the 70s. For many years, I did not see Rivon. I was told he was living in Longyat. He had become an amateur operator from then until his passing. We were very close. He moved to Warrens Park Christ Church. We were still in contact with each other. I started working at the gymnasium from 1993. After he retired from the Arawak cement plant, started walking around the gymnasium, I started about a year after walking with him on mornings. We share a lot of information with each other on satellite dishes, the Fire Stick, the smart boxes, which he programmed for many persons and never charged one cent. Many of mornings while walking with Rivon, he will say, "Andy, got to leave early. I have to take someone, an old friend of mine, to the doctor or to the hospital for medication." He said it was no problem of who the person was, he will do it. Don't matter. By the way, when Raul Chala died, he called me, I think that was around the 11th of April, and told me, "Andy, boy, we boy gone." I said, "Who was that?" He said, "Raul." I said, "Wow." He said, "Well, no problem." He said, "Well, I will get the chance now to collect Grace from the airport." he called Grace and told her, Grace, you don't have to worry now. I'm the only one. So I will collect you from the airport. But both of them are gone. And both of them used to work at Cable and Wireless together. There's one other person that I would ask, and that's Gaskin. He and Grace was very close, so he would have to pick her up from the airport. Anyhow, dealing now with Paddy. Paddy said that he'd known Rivon for approximately 8 years while walking around the gymnasium mornings. Plus other members of the group, there were quite, at least sometimes in the early to mid-90s, there were about close to about 60 persons that used to walk around the gymnasium, and that was one group. But a lot of them passed, and it just dwindled down to about 30, but become individual. And most of the time, Rivon, Paddy, Gaskin, Grace, there's quite a few of us that take a walk on mornings around the gymnasium. After Rivon got injured, Paddy would call him. Many of us would call him up, but Paddy would go and visit him and sometimes run errands for him and what's not. So, otherwise, conversation, all the other members that I asked to give a speech or write something, a note, this note says the same thing about Rivon over and over. And there's nothing, nobody can say anything that's different about Rivon. He was very knowledgeable, especially in local politics, current events. He gave good advice. He was very reliable and dependable. He could be very humorous when the occasion arises. But he sometimes, you know that, sometimes you get in some very heated discussions. Very heated. And at the end of the day, it's like nothing happened. Oh, by the way, I will call some names. Oh, let me go back a little further. Rivon has fought a good fight. And he has finished his course on earth. He will sadly be missed, and may he rest in peace and rise in glory. This is a few names of the walk group, the members. You have Grace, you have Jenny, you have Lorraine, you have the Leacocks, you have Allison and her dad, Paddy, Ronald, Gaskin, Cannon. Then you have Pierre, then you have Mr. Yao, Steve, Guy, Kathleen, Darley, Spooner, and myself, Andy. And last but not least, I have some food for thought. I will just feed you a spoonful of it. Black is a color, and white is also a color. But a black and white television is not a color television. If soap water makes the body clean, then what makes the toilet dirty after a bath? You're free to use a calculator. I thank you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Kindly be seated. We invite now Laura May to come and share words of remembrance.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for the support, the words of encouragement. I really want to thank the last two nurses that were with Daddy, Ali and Hara. I really want to thank them. I'm not sure if they're here, but they played an instrumental role in those last days in Daddy's life. So some of what I'm going to say you might have heard already, but it's part of my speech, so I'm going to read it. Words about Daddy. I never expected to be standing here. Daddy was supposed to live another 15 years at least. We were supposed to look back on his recent injury and marvel at the fact that he made it through a spinal surgery and worked his way back to cooking again on Sundays. In a clip they shared before we cut Daddy's 80th birthday cake back in 2020, he was flanked by both of us, his hands around our shoulders, and Daddy mused, "I wonder what will happen when I turn 100. I will look the same and life will be beautiful. You see these two?" His hands around us. "You see these two? They belong to me. Who don't like it, I'm sorry for them." And that was Daddy. "Who don't like it, I'm sorry for them." Daddy started his life humbly as one of eight children in rural St. James. His mother was a hawker and his dad planted canes. He was one of 26 boys who was privileged to pass for Combermere back in the days where back in the days when spaces were few and far between for poor people's children. Daddy was intelligent. He moved to town so he could go to school and easily made friends, many of whom he cherished till the day he died. He tried his hand at music, telling a story of how he mashed up a violin and the music teacher immediately took it back, and of his days playing cricket for the school he so loved. Daddy was great at cricket and vividly recalled his days playing on Saturdays at various fields across the island. Now, if anyone here knows my dad, you would know what brought his cricketing career to an end. Girls. He often mentioned how he figured out that the way to a girl's heart was not to be sweaty and tired on Saturday evenings, but rather to be smelling sweet and neatly dressed and heading to the cinema. That epiphany was the end of him and cricket. Daddy had dreams of working in radio and was accepted, and I'm not sure if it was to intern or to work at Radio Fusion, but he turned that job down in favor of better pay at customs. He worked in the hotel industry for some time. We heard Anderson say that he worked at Cable and Wireless, then at Covez, where he gave us all those beautiful dresses that Audra mentioned, because they were a garment manufacturer, before spending many years as marketing manager at the Arawak Cement plant. Even after retirement, Daddy kept on dreaming, working on various construction projects for us, his children, family, and friends. He was extremely active, very fit, walked around that gymnasium, I don't know, 5 or 6 times, 3 times a week, and he loved to learn new things. His mind was sharp to the end, and he taught today about his interest in video editing. Just prior to his passing, Audra mentioned this, they hatched a plan to begin a podcast on YouTube called Rivon's Facts of Life, and he went about getting my sister Audra to set up the channel for him. Daddy had a lot to say and wanted to ensure his legacy remained. It is in that vein that I share some of that legacy with you today through my experiences with him. So I'll start off as what it felt like being Daddy's child. The feeling was the epitome of love and acceptance. Daddy loved his children passionately. Audra, me, and Tovia. He was proud of each of us, and it was impossible to have a conversation with him where one of us did not come up. Everyone he came into contact knew about us. Daddy loved to tell the story of the day he was shopping in JB's and he bumped into a lady who was buying plantain chips and they started to chat. He was very affable. She explained she was getting them for her daughter and Daddy said he was doing the same. He asked her how old her daughter was and she said 8. She then asked Daddy how old his daughter was, and he flatly said, 41. And then he would laugh, and laugh, and laugh. He always wanted to make sure he had my favorite snack available when I stopped by. Daddy also planted a patch of juicy, so not just juicy when you suck them, but juicy was actually the name of the type of sugarcane, at the side of the house that belonged to my daughter. So special permission had to be sought for anyone else to get that cane. Daddy also showed his love in his acceptance of me, just the way I am, and by extension, love of my family. He and Day had a deep and special connection where his acceptance and love was palpable. Their bond went beyond me, and they talked, laughed, joked, listened to music, relaxed, and supported each other through these last 7.5 years. Day's biggest takeaway from their relationship is a sense of joy at his acceptance and remembrance to always keep moving. Daddy never stood still. Even when he was paralyzed in December 2020, he had a fierce determination to overcome his circumstances and in the end could walk 16 laps around his house. What a comeback. This love and acceptance extended to Antonio when he joined our family in 2015. Antonio and Daddy played cricket, Connect Four, flew kites, danced. You need to see the video of them dancing. And had many deep, manly conversations that Day and I were never privy to. Daddy filled a special place in Antonio's heart. And throughout his recovery, Antonio prayed for him every day as he said his grace before meals. My father cooked for me and then us for almost 10 years, each and every Sunday, with the exception of Sundays in the month of December when he would go out for lunch at various friends' homes. Daddy called it vacation. He said, I am not cooking for y'all in the month of December. I am on vacation, y'all break for y'all self. He was a good cook, very consistent, and we look forward to those weekly meals. Daddy told me that there were people he knew who questioned, and I don't know if any of you are here, but who questioned why he had to cook for his daughter every week. But he shrugged it off, he shrugged off those questions, and did what made him happy. The cooking started when I was going through a rough time in 2011, and he started inviting me over for food. That was his way of showing his love and support, and we just kept that going. In 2018, when my mother was diagnosed with cancer, some of those Sunday meals got packaged and sent over for her. He made sure the presentation was just right, as he knew she was a stickler for presentation, and he wanted to make her happy. He was a constant support to me during the period of her illness. He picked her up, dropped her off, called her just to talk and keep her company, and filled in where I could not. I felt his love during that period. It was tangible. He was there, and it made the world of difference to me. I didn't grow up in a house with Daddy, so I've always said that he may have been late to the party, but he stayed till the end. And I will forever be grateful for the time we spent together, eating, talking, laughing, planning, dreaming, and hoping. So the other vantage point is me observing Daddy being a friend. He provided unending support to all of you and all of those he called friend. Daddy made and kept many friends throughout the years. Many of these relationships started when he left home and moved to the Bayland area at age 10. His friendships with Ronald, Phillips, Dadu, Hendy, and Hal stood the test of time. Names like Celeste, Mary, Scotty, and Harry were always on his lips. He embraced them and their families throughout the years and was a constant support to them all. And I cannot say Phillips without saying Serlene. No way, and Serlene, always talking about Serlene. Daddy was the one to be called for a drop to the supermarket, a pickup at the airport, to fix a box or a computer, or for advice on construction, taxes, property, wills, or anything else he could help with. I recall Daddy helping his dancing instructor Dennis with computer issues he had from time to time, but his support didn't end there. Dennis taught a dance class, and my dad was one of the few men in attendance, so Daddy would dutifully dance with all the female participants and assist with teaching them the steps. Now, I know what you think when I say that, because I said he liked girls, But when I tried to say that to him, he said, no, Laura, there was a lot of standing on my toes and hitting my knees. It wasn't easy. When women learn how to dance, it ain't easy. He loved his dance class, but I think he loved being of service more. He taught me how to be a true friend. He taught me how to show up for my friends as he did. So what has he left behind? You heard the motto in the song. He left that behind for sure. Thank you for putting that in. That was Daddy's voice that you are all hearing, for those who might not have recognized it. He left an example of love that sees past differences and opinions. He left an example of friendship that is always there when it matters most. He left an example of strength and determination that pushes through difficult circumstances and sees a brighter tomorrow to which one could hold fast. An optimism that could never be shattered, he always looked ahead. To the last day of Daddy's life, Daddy was looking ahead. Daddy said to the guys that he walked with, if I could walk 16 laps around my house, I could do one lap at the gymnasium. And he was ready to come back out. He was ready to buy the Mercedes, which is why we have the Mercedes-Benz logo. Daddy always wanted to own a Mercedes, always looking ahead. He left a reminder to do the things that bring you joy and surround yourself with the people that you loved. In short, a life well lived, hearts deeply touched, and memories that will never fade. Thank you.
I would like for us to just sing that chorus again. Then sings my soul. And the music don't have to cue in, we know it well all. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul. How great thou art. And that great Savior we were just singing about created the man Rivon Cleophas. Let me make sure I get his name right. He seemed to be very particular. Skeete. I speak to you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Kindly sit for a few words of reflection. It is very interesting when we come to services such as this, as we hear words and as we sing the hymns and we hear the scriptures, it is a reminder that in times like these, we go back to the Savior, the one who created us. And very often people say, but how did Jesus react? How does he identify with us even now in our time of grief? The way in which Jesus responds to death can be seen in the gospel according to St. John chapter 11 at the death of his friend Lazarus. In that particular scripture, it gives us a lot of insight into the ways that God the Father might expect us to respond when our own has been called home. Probably today, Mr. Skeete is saying, all right, they're getting their facts right, because there are two little facts here that that scripture tells us about. It says that Jesus wept. The outward sign of showing of his sorrow. This sorrow touched him too, the death of his good friend Lazarus. And maybe you cried when your good friend passed, your dad passed, your granddad passed. Even though you're happy that he was a part of your life, maybe there was a moment when a tear was shed. It also says that he groaned in his spirit. And so maybe for the king of the house, the king, that's what they call you, sir? The rose between the two thorns? Right. Maybe you did not cry. Yes, don't throw me out yet. I saw the ladies, your sisters looking really strange at me. But maybe for you, you did not cry out tears, but you groaned inside in your spirit. In that inner depth, the pain of losing a dad. A pain that no one can understand or you cannot express, not even in words. But somewhere along the line, my brothers and sisters, and as a good friend, death calls you to stop and to grieve for the loss of a good friend. But I want to say to us who are present in the service this evening that as we come to say goodbye and to give God thanks for the life of the brother, his death has shown us three things. One, we should remember. And we sure did have some memories this evening as we heard his daughters share with you about their dad and all the things that he meant to them. And from his good friend, Anderson, what it meant for this gentleman to be his friend and all the other people who walk and are fitter than some of us are, which includes me. Jesus wept because I believe he remembered. He remembered the person Lazarus was. He remembered the time he had eaten and fellowshiped together in their home. And I guess when Laura May was talking about her dad, she remembered the times when she ate. She gave me the thumbs up. I trust that while she was there, she learned the recipes so that she's now able to carry on. But Jesus remembered the time at his friend's home. He remembered the time that Martha had gotten all upset because her sister Mary did not come to help her prepare the goodies for when Jesus was visiting, but rather taught to sit at his feet to eat of the spiritual food. Today, as we think of your loved one, you too will remember him for what he meant to you. And maybe a word or a phrase which was said in both of the tributes, or even in the song, or even hearing his voice after the singing of that song, the tribute in song, that brought back memories to you of the one of whom we say goodbye to today. Death causes us to remember. But it does not only cause us to remember. We should also learn that death teaches us to review our own lives. And as I sat there and I heard about this gentleman, I started to look at my own life and to recall the relationship that I had with my dad, who just passed also. That, you know, as I review my life, are there things in my life that I need to forget about and zero in more on? When my time come and I go, would my life be of such that it calls others to review? I'm certain that Mr. Skeet, and I'm calling him that so that I don't get his name wrong, so it's better to say Mr. Skeet, I'm sure that he was not perfect. He would have made his mistakes. But as we hear about him and how he interact with others, we too are called to review our own lives and our relationship with each other. But death does not only ask us to review our own life and our relationship with each other, but it asks us also to review our own life and our relationship with the God who made us. You see, Jesus asked Martha and then later Mary, do you remember the things I told you? Do you recall the times we talked about eternity? What do you believe about those things? And very often people are not really interested about the eternal things. They just want to identify with the things here on earth. But death asks us to consider that, to review. What do you think about eternity? And Jesus asks Martha, Mary, do you still trust me? Do you still think that I can do something about this situation? And we know the story when Jesus went to the rock tomb where Lazarus was buried and called him forth and he came back from the dead. And certainly we wish that we could probably ask the same thing to happen now. But even more so, it asks us, do you trust me to walk with you in this your time of grief? Do you trust me with your life that at the end of your days here on earth, I may receive you in eternity? Do you believe that I am resurrection and I am life? We are still in the period of Easter, a reminder that Jesus died, but he rose again from the dead. And that those of us who believe and accept him, one day when we die, we too shall rise from the dead. And the question Jesus asks of us now, even in the midst of your grief, do you still believe that I am resurrection and that I am life? And that I will walk with you during this period? But this is not the end of things. One day our brother too would rise. And one of the most beautiful things is that at the end of our life to hear those assuring words, as his daughter said, that with everything her dad was about, he was interested in spiritual things. Even if it came at the end or near the end of his life. So you and I have the opportunity, even in this service, to look at our own life, to see our relationship with each other, and also to see our relationship with the one that created us. And the last and the third fact is that we should also learn that death teaches us to refocus our direction. Suddenly, possessions and plans didn't seem very important to Martha and Mary and the other family members. And if I should ask you this evening, have you noticed that when faced with death, that our plans and possessions suddenly don't seem so important after all? When we think of our loved ones who have either died or are dying, if we truly love them and if we truly have a relationship with them, then who gets the house and who gets his hat and who will get the money to buy the Mercedes? Yeah, I see his granddaughter nodding. But you know what? All those things are not so important anymore when you think about the value of the relationship that you have with the person. In the story, Martha and Mary's perspectives had changed. Maybe their belief had become a little burly, you know, cloudy over time. Maybe because of the unexpectedness of Lazarus' death, there was uncertainty about life in general. But Jesus came. Jesus came alongside them And that, by the way, is what he's doing for each one of you this evening who are grieving over the death of Mr. Skeete. And he said, I am the one who have the final answer. I am resurrection and I am life. My brothers and sisters, James 4:14 reminds us what is life. You are mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Your loved one has a long and reasonable life. I'm sure he didn't plan to get ill. I heard he wanted to live to 100. So he didn't plan. But that is the life we live. Our planning and our life is not in our hands. All that is in our hands is what we do with our lives. So since life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then passes away, and since it was his time to go, he has given to each one of you present here a very valuable and loving gift. That is to stop and to think about how fragile life is. We can't boast about tomorrow, we can plan, but the important thing is what we do with now. The passage of Lazarus reminds us that even though life is fragile, we have hope. We have a life in Jesus Christ. And so for all of us who are present here this evening, yes, we understand that life is unpredictable. We don't even know what will happen today, much less the next week or next year. The truth is that no one can predict the future. But today, Jesus says, I am. And when you accept him as the one who is able to walk with you and to hold you during life circumstances, then you can live your life with a purpose. Family and friends, today you mourn the loss of your loved one, a man who would have shown you how to make the best of life, a man who would have shown you that your days are numbered, but to live them with wisdom, a man who has gone on, leaving a legacy behind for his grandchildren, for his daughters, for his son, and for his friends, but also a man who today gives you the gift of remembering, reviewing, and refocusing your life. I pray that the God who created him would receive him into his hands, and that the Good Shepherd will continue to hold this family during this period of grief and walk with them in the days ahead. It is for you to accept his gift of comfort and love. May God continue to bless you. May his banner of love continue to overshadow you, and his everlasting arms continue to uphold you, not only today, but in the days ahead. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, grant us, Lord, the wisdom and the grace to use aright the times that is left to us here on earth. Lead us to repent of our sins, the evil we have done and the good we have failed to do, and strengthen us to follow the steps of your Son in the way that leads to the fullness of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Kindly stand now as we commend our brother. Let us commend our brother, Rivon Cleophas Skeete, to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Heavenly Father, by your mighty power, you have given us new life in Christ Jesus. We entrust this, our brother, Rivon Cleophas, to your merciful keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died and rose to save us and is now alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us go forth then in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Brightly, and the flowers don't wanna bloom. Seems like the sun got lazy. It wakes up in the afternoon. The wind don't wanna bloom.
Everyone who's alive, live for today. Yesterday is a memory and tomorrow is a vision. But every today well spent makes every yesterday a wonderful memory and every tomorrow a vision of hope. That's my motto, my motto.
Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart therefore is glad and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, saith the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to the Lord who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. Ensure uncertain hope of resurrection to eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother, Rivon Cleophas, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirit of those who die in the Lord and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good example of all your servants who have finished their course to find in faith, and now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord. We pray for this family. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Please.
The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. And unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory, with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. The hymn, "The Day Thou Givest, Lord," is ending.
Thank you.
You have been our refuge from one generation to another. Before the mountains were brought forth, or the land and the earth were born, from age to age you are God. You turn us back to the dust and say, go back, O child of the earth. For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it's past, and like a watch in the night. You sweep us away like a dream. We fade away suddenly like the grass. In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it dries up and withers. For we consume away in your displeasure. We are afraid because of your wrath and indignation. Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance. When you are angry, all the days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labor and sorrow, for they pass away quickly and we are gone. Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation? So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long will you tarry? Be gracious to your servant. Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning. So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. Make us glad by the measure of the days that you afflicted us, and in the years in which we suffer adversity. Show your servant your works and your splendor to their children. May the graciousness of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper the work of our hands. Prosper our handiwork. We sing now the next hymn. When the roll is called up yonder,
the Lord shall send the sun, shall be your Lord, and the glory praises you.
shall fly away.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have flown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, this your servant who has gone before us with the sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace according to your promises. Grant to him and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ, O Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rests and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.